If Modi's first and second terms were to save Indians, toilets, gas, tap water, loans, bank accounts, health insurance, homes, COVID vaccines, Balakot, the third must be one that saves India. The Hindus do not ask for appeasement, they never have. The Hindus do not even mind if people belonging to other religions are appeased. They were now living in a fascist state where Muslim rights were being stomped upon by brown-shirted, goose-stepping Hindutva soldiers. 10 years of apathy and inaction, of prejudice, of constitutional and judicial discrimination, not against Muslims, but against Hindus. One must ask, what kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where a billion strong Hindus have been through our parliament, courts, education system and our constitution reduced to not just second class but rather eighth class citizens? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where Durga Puja and Garba celebrations are stoned with impunity, where a sitting prime minister claims minorities are the first claim to resources?
Innovative plans to ensure that minorities, particularly the Muslim minority, are empowered to share equitably in the fruits of development. They must have the first claim on our resources.
What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where Hindus are forced to be refugees in their own land? That time has come for Prime Minister Modi to stop discrimination against a billion Hindus. Discrimination that is legal, social, educational and constitutional. My heartiest congratulations to Narendra Modi and the BJP and the NDA on this historic day. To take oath as the Prime Minister for a third successive term, an occurrence that has transpired after 60 years, quite remarkable. I'm confident he will provide a stable, secure government for the next 5 years. But in many ways, this historic 2024 mandate has made Prime Minister Modi's job arduous. How does one formulate a policy, shore up one's resolve, promulgate an ordinance, pass an act that will do justice to the faith of a billion people that they have bestowed on a man not once, not twice, but for a third successive time? In one pan lies this faith, this intangible that goes beyond data and delivery. What must be laden on the pan opposite? Can faith be balanced with a little bank reform or a promise of a pothole-free national highway or the cleaning of a tributary or clerical easing in setting up a shop or a business or a ceremonial cutting of bureaucratic red tape? One can balance out demand, sure, but how does one balance out faith? The toilets have been made, all 120 million of them. Gas connections supplied, 100 million of them. Health cards distributed, 350 million of them. Micro loans provided, 430 million of them. Homes constructed, 40 million of them. Jobs given, 85 million of them. Bank accounts opened, 600 million of them. Indians are healthier, wealthier, wiser. They're traveling faster, cheaper. They're living safer, longer, being defended better. Inequality has decreased. Stock market is at its highest ever. What does one do now? A little more of the same? More toilets, more schools, more gas cylinders? Would that balance the faith? Welfarism is a necessity for a developing country, and so it must be. That said, to commit to welfare and then to realize it is not a difficult decision for any government to make. Every politician is elected on the promise of delivering welfare. But there comes a tipping point. And sooner or later, that point is reached first by those who elect and not by those who are elected. There is only so many toilets to be made, so many taps to be connected, so many bank accounts to be opened. And once they are, the voters need something more than the basic amenities. That time has come. That time has come for Prime Minister Modi to stop discrimination against a billion Hindus, discrimination that is legal, social, educational and constitutional. To address this issue later would be too late. Quite possibly, it already is. If Modi's first and second terms were to save Indians, toilets, gas, tap water, loans, bank accounts, health insurance, homes, COVID vaccines, Balakot, the third must be one that saves India. And India cannot be saved if Hindus aren't. The Hindus do not ask for appeasement, they never have. The Hindus do not even mind if people belonging to other religions are appeased. All the Hindus ask for is that the discrimination carried out against them be ebbed, if not stopped altogether. Is that too much to ask? The proverbial Hindu Rashtra, a rhetorical derisory reference to the dawn of 2014 coined by the left, to guilt trip Indians into believing that they were now living in a fascist state where Muslim rights were being stomped upon by brown-shirted, goose-stepping Hindutva soldiers, has just celebrated its 10th anniversary. 10 years of apathy and inaction, of prejudice, of constitutional and judicial discrimination, not against Muslims, but against Hindus. To those who claim we are now living in a totalitarian Hindu Rashtra, one must ask, what kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where a billion strong Hindus have been through our parliament, courts, education system and our constitution reduced to not just second class, but rather eighth class citizens? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where Durga Puja and Garba celebrations are stoned with impunity, where a sitting prime minister claims minorities are the first claim to resources? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where Hindus are forced to be refugees in their own land, where one can resettle or settle 40,000 Rohingya Muslims, but not 700,000 Kashmiri Hindus, the land's original inhabitants, where the judiciary says not once but twice that it is too late to prosecute those who raped, murdered and ethnically cleansed Hindus? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where Hindu temples are exclusively controlled by the state and Hindus must beg for Waqf land to celebrate their festivals? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where the Right to Education Act discriminates only against Hindus and their schools, forcing thousands of them to shut down? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where genocidal monsters like Aurangzeb and Tipu are eulogized through state-sponsored publications, naming of roads and organizing of festivals? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where a law was about to be enacted through which only the Hindus would have been held guilty in a communal riot, even if they were in a minority, for example, in Kashmir? What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where court judgments like the Sabarimala and legislative enactments like the Hindu Court Bill purport to reform only Hindu religious practices, but dare not touch practices of other religions? And if they do, their decisions are promptly reversed, like in the Shah Bano case. What kind of a Hindu Rashtra is this where the Places of Worship Act continues to deny Hindus their legitimate right to correct historical injustices, where the Waqf Act gives overarching powers to Muslims to declare a 1500-year-old Hindu temple to be on Islamic land when Islam is only 1300 years old? If this is how a Hindu is rewarded in a Hindu Rashtra, honestly, he'd much rather be in a Muslim Rashtra, because then at least there'll be no pretense of equality. A kafir will get what he deserves. Prime Minister Modi, I'm sorry, but all religions are not the same. Sarv Dharma Sambhav is a cool aid we and a billion others have been forced to gulp down for generations. It has guilt-tripped us into a downward spiral of self-loathing. Please understand, for India to survive as a plural, all-accepting land, Hinduism and Hindus must survive. And they will not, as long as we have legislations that discriminate against Hindu temples, Hindu schools, Hindu rights, Hindu refugees and Hindu history. The Waqf Act must be abrogated. So must the Places of Worship Act and the Temple Endowment Act. Right to Education Act must be amended. Kashmiri Hindus must be resettled in the valley. Predictably, there would be millions who would oppose this, for they want discrimination against Hindus to continue. This is the means to an end that their religion demands from them in return for heavenly rewards. They will seed and sprout 1,000 Shaheen Baghs. They will block roads, light up campuses, write column yards here and abroad. Let them. You must stand up to them, Mr. Modi. This term, Narendra Modi, you need to fight for our survival, not yours. You need to choose dharma over coalition dharma. Will you? Can you?